Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us on this webinar today. I hope you have a good time. Please don't hesitate to post your comments and questions, especially in the chat box. We will be having a small Q&A as the very last piece of this meeting. So make sure that you post your questions and we'll be happy to answer them for you. So first of all, just a quick round of introductions, who we are and what we do. So here with me is Chris van der Hilden, a dear friend of mine from Inetum Real Dolmen, Belgium. He's been a subject matter expert for almost a decade with professional experience in guiding the companies and clients into the IoT area and consulting them on how to do that properly and with great success. I myself, my name is Przemysław Saniak. I'm a sales executive for Inetum Poland, where we take great interest and have good experience with implementing IoT projects. In case you're wondering who we are at Inetum, we're an international IT services company supporting our partners and clients on an end-to-end basis, providing consulting services, designing, building and running solutions, as well as acting as a system integrator and providing sourcing services for top talent. We're 27,000 people strong in 27 countries, in Europe, Latin and Africa regions. We focus on projects that introduce new ways of doing businesses, including cloud computing, mass data processing, and smart industries, to name a few, part of which is also IoT, which will be the subject of our today's meeting. But before we jump into that, I wanna take a minute to talk about how we structure our webinar. So today's meeting is part of the series of webinars tackling different aspects of companies' engagement in the IoT sector. So we have a company strategy and IoT strategy as part of the what we call four horsemen of the IoT. Then we have portfolio strategy. And last but not least, project development on top of those three as well. We believe that those four horsemen should be taken into consideration while setting up your IoT program for success. Today, we will be discussing the strategic approach, tackling both company strategy and more specifically IoT strategy. During the second meeting, we will touch on portfolio strategy, and the third meeting that we have planned will be built around project development itself. But before we jump into more details, let's have a quick survey, if you don't mind. I would like to ask you, do you have an IoT strategy in place? Please cast your votes now.
It's also a quick test. See if we can change your mind. If some certain companies think we already have an IoT strategy in place, we want to see at the end if this was really the case after we finished this this webinar.
All right, 5 more seconds, and we'll be closing down the poll right about now. Thank you.
All right, and I'll take over. We'll discuss the results at the end. So basically what we want to do is we want to bring a few things together. And this is the company and the IoT strategy together with the portfolio strategy and the project development. Those are the three different webinars we do. And what we want to show that there's a clear dependency and a clear need to make dependencies between the company strategy and the IoT strategy, later between the portfolio and strategy and IoT, and then portfolio and project development. The company strategy is quite clear. Often there are already some rules in place. The question is, how do you translate this into an IoT strategy? Because we want to clarify that there's really a need, and a lot of companies, they're not yet at the level that they really want to have a company-wide IoT strategy in place. Mostly they focus on certain domains, and what we want to do is to make a change in mentality there, because IoT becomes a big part of the organizational fabric of a company, and that means that we need to pay a lot of attention to what we're doing there. Now, before we start, IoT is here to stay. Cope with it. It's not going away. There's no need for less connectivity. There's no need for less IoT in the future. It's going to be more. And just like the automobile, the computer, and the mobile phone, things are here to stay. IoT will evolve, but it will stay. So there's a moment to think about how are we structuring all of this IoT, which is coming into our organization. And then the second
point, I have a tricky question here for you, Chris.
Yes.
Do you think that just like the examples that you've shown, so the computer, the automobile, will the IoT revolutionize the industry as well?
It will evolve more than revolutionize. It's focused on a lot of as a service models these days, where we do have an impact. It's the intended goal of IoTs is working towards a more connected company, and then IoT becomes a crucial part of that. I don't know if you would call that revolutionize or change, but it's definitely evolving. It's next step in connectivity and data mining.
Thanks for your insight.
People that know me, that have had some presentations from me, they know that I always talk about the 50-50-50 rule. And I want you also to keep that in the back of your mind while we go through this presentation, because it's easy to get tunnel vision and to look at like a single solution and say, hey, this is great for us. But you need to know that even at this point, probably your organization already has 5, 10, 15 different solutions. And what it brings with it is that you have to multiply everything. You have to multiply towards 50 dashboards, 50 SLAs, 50 types of integration, 50 types of maintenance, the training, the security, and the processes. And it becomes exponentially more difficult the more solutions that you implement, willingly or unwillingly. And this has a clear impact on your solution manageability, your portfolio manageability, because it has impact on your people and your processes as well.
So do you think, Chris, that...
Sorry, I'm going too quick.
Sorry. Do you think it's safe to say that going further and further into such segmented environments doesn't really make sense for the company, and what type of risks does it bring to the company to have such an unstructured environment?
Well, the thing is, not for a single solution there will not be a problem, because you can clearly define what you want to do with it. It's just that once you start building up solution on solution, you'll end up something with a room which has 4 or 5 different sensors in there, one for CO2, one for room monitoring, one for security, and so on. If you don't have a clear vision where you want to go, then this just multiplies on maintenance, it multiplies on costs, and you cannot do an efficient management of all of your solutions at the same time. Nobody knows exactly what's going on then there, and even now probably nobody knows what type of IoT is deployed in your company. So it is impactful, and I have a slide later as well to explain a bit more on that section.
All right.
So how do we start the projects today?
All right. Yeah. Guide us through it.
Yeah. The thing is that we need to have an approach for this webinar. So looking at the possibilities where projects originate from. And this is usually or the business units where a lot of projects start because they have a specific need, or it's IT, they're more platform focused, or it's innovation that wants to test new things and so on. So those are the elements where usually the projects start. It's not always the case. What we want to do today is look at the problems and the challenges that you have in each of these business, in each of these units. We want to see if it's the right place to nest an IoT solution and start it from there, and that's what we want to look at today In the next session, when we look at portfolio management, we'll see more why this is so important to make some decisions there. And before we dive into that, we really need to see, we need to agree on a few principles, because even if we go through this session, there are a number of things that if we don't look at them, if we don't constantly do a litmus test with these ones, then we'll end up with effectively like these 50 different solutions with 50 different dashboards and so on. And looking at the core thing where I think everybody agrees on, it needs to be secure. It needs to be scalable. It needs to be data interoperable. If you want to go towards a connected company, and clearly there needs to be some compliance with your company rules, your company setup, your company policies. And then there needs to be a continuity. It's good to connect something, but it needs to stay connected.
So you mentioned security. I mean, it seems obvious and crucial nowadays that you should have your IT infrastructure tightly secured, under control, under policies and whatnot. How does it really look like in the IoT world, though?
Well, partly it does align. You need to know that your IoT rules, they align and they are very similar to the ones that you want to apply to the IT section of IoT, which is not the same thing. On the other hand, you need to know that there are suddenly devices that are in public. They're small mini computers. They connect to a network. They connect to. Right. They gather data that might not be crucial for a company to put processes on, or they might be GDPR they might impact your GDPR policies. So it is partly true, but you need to expand it. You need to be looking at a lot of topics, and I do follow the Microsoft approach there, where you chop up your IoT solution in different sections, from your hardware, your network, your gateways, again your network, your platform, and from there you secure each of these sections. You do a risk analysis. Not every solution needs to be 100% secured. That's not the point, but you need at least to know where your leaks are.
You mentioned GDPR. Thinking of GDPR, you usually think about personal data, right? So how is it important for IoT solutions to be compliant with GDPR?
Well, it's the moment you start gathering data, your data is processed and put together in a central core or in an IoT platform. While each of these data streams might not be GDPR riskful, I'll call it like that. If you put them together, you might identify some people, and you might be able to track some people, and you might to find out what they're doing. And sometimes that even spills over in the privacy of the home of the workers or of clients where you deploy these solutions. So you need to be very careful there. You need to make an analysis. You might want to treat certain riskful data. You want to maybe separate it from your streams and limit access to that one as well.
Now the main concern is usually that while gathering data is the quality of data that is gathered. How would setting up those principles help ensuring the high quality of data?
It's partly already treated in the section of data contextualization, but I'll quickly go through it and I'll answer your question while we go through it. So I put some tags. I put some tags there which are relevant with security. I do want to stress there that a lot of companies they apply third-party solutions and they say, okay, let's put this because it's an off-the-shelf solution. Also, we will cover that a bit later. But there is not necessarily a due diligence done there on that company, and you don't know if they will still exist in 2 years or 3 years, and then your investment might go out of the window. On scalability, not all solutions are scalable, and you want to have that built into your framework. One of them is, for example, if you work with a limited amount of platforms, which makes a lot of sense because you don't want this complexity. You work with a number of platforms. Within these platforms, you will host and several solutions, and you need to have a system in place that does the cost distribution, because you want not you don't want the overhead to fall on one solution. You want to spread it out, and that's something that needs to be put in place for your scalability of your solution. If you look at data interoperability, then I would pick out contextualization and metadata, because if you build solutions, then you need to keep in mind that at the end, somebody will work with this data. So you'll have an analytics team that needs to use this data to make decisions on procurement or decisions on maintenance or whatever. So they need to know where this data is coming from. They need to know how reliable this data is. So you want to add some indexes to your metadata, to your data. So seeing how critical it is, how reliable it is, how secure it is before you start implementing it into an analytics tool or in another application. And this contextualization helps you also to manage your full environment. I'm hearing the pings all of the time. So this is a very important part. You need to be in control not only of your IoT solution, but also the data that comes out of it. And then compliance. You want your solution to be compliant with your company policies. You want it to be compliant with your legal elements, your ICT structure, and so on. On continuity, it's easy to connect something. It's much more difficult to keep it connected for the next five to 10 years. Because there's a lot of false data out there, especially if we look at battery life. Battery life companies that sell the devices, they say, it goes 10 years. And in reality, it's then 3 years or 4 years. But that has a really big impact on your TCO of your solution.
Right.
So getting back a bit on how projects start today, and then I look at the business units, and often, not all of the time, but often they look at something which I call prêt-à-porter, which means that basically you buy something off the shelf and then you implement it within your organization to streamline some processes. And that could be for reducing waste or automate your fleet management, can be logistic, or 100 or 200 different solutions or different needs that you can resolve with IoT. Then there's a market scan, often by a vendor. There's often some research done. And then after that, there's a business plan that is made, which is often not that difficult, because the vendor of the solution or the off-the-shelf solution, they already have a number of components there. You do some testing, and then you deploy it. You apply your SLA, and you train the people to work with the system. And that's basically it. So that's the solution, this prêt-à-porter, or this off-the-shelf solutions. Usually, they're quite successful. Of all of the solutions, they're the most successful. Why? Because your time to implement is very short. It's very short because it's already been done, and the processes are in place, and so on. It has the highest success rate, again, for the same reason, because people already have done this. And then there's the best budget control. Of course, you know what you're paying for, and so on. Now, the question is this a solution that should be generalized within your company? And then I would have some question marks. Because as I said, and that's the reason why we did this first element with some agreed on principles, we should still ask ourselves, is it secure, scalable, data interoperable, compliant? And then right. I would say, and I'm sure I would say no. You have a question, Samak?
I mean, I try to imagine the situation. So you have a reliable vendor, you have a business need, obviously, at the very bottom of it. You have a reliable vendor with battle-proof solution that solves the problem, meets your every need, has high success rate of implementation. Then why would that be bad, even like when it solves your immediate problem?
Yeah, and it comes down to is it secure? And I would honestly say no, it's not secure. You're working often with startups or scale-ups. IoT is new. Don't forget, IoT exists 10 years. So on security, What do you know about this company? How many people have access to your data? If they go on holiday, who is the backup? What are they doing there? If is it hackable? Do they have a disaster and recovery plan? And often you see those questions are not asked because people are not used to asking that to vendors, especially because what we see now is that a lot of these startups and scale-ups, they are now posing behind respectable companies. Companies, and I'm not going to name them, but companies that say, okay, we are an integrator. They look on the market for some solutions and then they put right. them. But the engine still stays the same. Are they scalable? In theory, yes, but there is a big change if you look if you scale up from 100,000 to 1 million devices, that might be that some of the components of the solution might need to be redesigned. So scalable, it's not guaranteed even all if they have already a number of things in place. Data interoperability. What you're doing if you buy a solution like this, it's often a silo solution. So you still want to integrate it and then think about it. Who's responsible for the API management? I know companies that suddenly change their API settings, the vendors, and then suddenly the integration didn't work anymore. But that's not so great if you integrate that in an SAP process or some in an SAP tool or whatever. Compliance. This is a bit of a joke if you don't have IoT policies in place, because what are you going to make it compliant against if you don't have special IoT policies in place? So I would say
strategy. You don't have policies, right?
Yeah. Well, the policies are dependent on your strategy. So clearly, you don't have. You didn't do the check. I already know that. And then the last section, the continuity. I know about 50 platforms that stopped working the last 2 years in Europe, in the Benelux even. So you're not guaranteed. Sales cycles are very long. Companies are very hesitant to implement this. And then suddenly the dreams and the hopes of these startups and scale-ups, they are focused on something else where they think they're going to make more money and they stop or they get bought or whatever. So there's a lot of questions now. Multiply this again within your organization and do this 50 times. And then you say, okay, this is a good strategy, but you multiply the amount of question marks if you don't have anything in place. You need to know that it needs to be part of your corporate strategy still, then your IoT strategy, which is often not that defined yet. Then we have the portfolio strategy as well. How are you gonna manage that within an ecosystem of solutions? And then your solution development is less important in this case because it's already developed. That's that section, and then it's a good question to ask if that's okay. And I know that it's tempting to buy something off the shelf and implement it. But the question is it all okay for you? Is it okay to build new silos if you want to go to a connected company? Is it okay that you might have a vendor lock because you're locked into this company and they provide the devices, so you cannot change if you need to change something? Where's your flexibility there? You don't have the impact on those customers. And it goes on. Is it okay that you don't know who has access to your data? And it's also, everybody can say it's okay, but at the end, we have to be fair with each other. It's not really okay. Definitely not if you multiply your question marks over those 50 different solutions. And people say 50, why 50? And then I often do the exercise with companies and they already have 20, 30 implemented. Some they don't even know about. There are already people that gather data from their company and use that somewhere else. So
isn't that like the typical scenario is that some companies, they don't want to blow it out of proportion. They don't want to start on a high level. They just want to test the waters within the IoT just for one or two use cases and see if they can come up with something bigger, and they get stuck on that. What do you think?
Well, it sometimes is the case. people do get stuck, but once you go down a road and people are trained and the processes are put in place, and it's really difficult to start changing again and say, hey, you did this wrong, just stop working with this solution because it's not cure. People often don't do that. I don't say it's always necessary, but please do consider the risks there.
Right.
So definitely, and this is why we put in place these rules and these guidelines specifically for IoT, because IoT becomes part of your company. It is part of your company culture, your mission, your strategy, your the products that you sell, and then you want to streamline these processes. You want to optimize your implementation of IoT, if it's whatever solution it is. And I have some tensions, if I am honest, I have some tensions with vendors of these solutions, the startups and the scale-ups that really want to be selling. And sometimes they ask to help with the customer or to implement it. And then they are not that happy that I say, let's go back and let's do the IoT policies first, because it slows them down. Or they say, okay, but then maybe we're not compliant. Maybe we don't fit the exact needs, and now the customer doesn't know. But that's exactly why I'm there. I'm there to say, if your company doesn't, if you're afraid that your solution doesn't meet the company policies, if we put them in place, then why would I want to sell them now? You change your solution, but your customer doesn't have to be ignorant. And it's about putting these foundations in place. That's why you want to put an IoT strategy. You want to have a foundation where you can say, okay, the next solution will put on this or on that. And that can be a multi-platform strategy as well.
Right.
Ready for a quick survey?
All right, let's head on to the survey number two. Sorry, just let me. Right. So we would like to ask you, should a connected coffee machine be part of your IoT strategy? Please don't hesitate to vote. There's no right or wrong answers. And we're looking forward to gathering those votes and talking about them later on.
Here, I would like to have the results, to be honest, Samak. See if anybody says yes or anybody says no.
I know you like your coffee, and you treat your coffee seriously, so I know that's your favorite question. All right, we'll be closing down the poll in just a few seconds, so cast your vote, please. And the poll is now closed, and we're going back to Chris.
All right. Can you tell me what the percentage is? Because I don't see that on my screen.
I'm gonna share that with you but it's not that surprising though.
Okay. Well, let's just assume it needs to be part of your policies, because your connected coffee machine is something that somebody else might bring in, and it doesn't matter if it's a coffee machine which can listen into the conversations of the people that are standing around it and send the data through. It needs to be part of your general policies. Even if you purchase it, even if it's third-party solutions that are offered, you need to know which data is gathered locally and which is how it is used, if it's anonymized, if you agree on those ones, and that's part of your exercise that you need to do. And a coffee machine might sound a bit harmless, unless if I say it's listening into your conversation. But imagine you have a CNC machine you want to deploy, and you say, okay, we have all of the rules internally, we put on a digital twin, we put all the security in place there. Many of these machines today, they have a SIM card inside as well for the manufacturer to see if there are error codes to do maintenance. Again, that might be a security risk, and nobody looks at it, but if they can enter that way in your network, do you take that in consideration when you put on your put on your security policies? Do you know that suddenly can hack your supplier? That's not. I see a question here. I don't see all of the questions. What is the best step for a production company before
starting? Let's just take the questions at the very end, okay? And
all right.
Maybe some of those will be answered during the presentation.
All right. So let's move on then. So the first section, it was about the prêt-à-porter, so the solutions that are brought in by a business unit to see something they really wanted. The second one is a bit more complex. It's IT. IT is ordered to support a business unit with a new solution, or they want to put some new models in the market, or they get a directive from a CEO or whatever, and they say, okay, we need to centralize the data on one platform. It makes no sense to we are aware of this 50-50-50 rule. We need to centralize the data and then start managing from a central platform. I call that platform IoT because it's originating, it's built around the platform by the IT team. Now, the spoiler alert, I already put it on the screen. IoT is about 10-20% IT, and all of the rest is people, processes, and other stakeholders, and everything that goes around it. So putting all of the elements and all of the weight onto the IT department, it doesn't really help anything forward. And people that are responsible for an IoT platform, they know they need to talk with people. They know they need to bring everybody together. So the IT unit might run into some problems. And what I can say, if you look at the problem at the platform itself, when would I say, without going into the details, it's a job well done? If you have flexibility by design, IoT is changing all of the time. New networks are coming. You want to be ready to adapt it. Even within a single solution, you might have different devices that do the same thing, or additional sensors that are added, or so on, because everything is evolving. So you want this flexibility. You want to interchange components quickly. Again, your data contextualization is important there. Because if you contextualize the data, then you can use that still in your analytics tools with different indexes. So that's very important. Security by design, we often talk about security mesh, but please bring it all the way through the vendor of the machine, if it's a CNC machine or whatever, a connected device that you bring in that you want to connect. Put all of the blocks on the board and then evaluate block per block. Attention for cost distribution. I know a lot of projects that start and that say, okay, we have one or two solutions and we want to test and put a platform on top of it. The overhead might be very heavy. And then afterwards, when you add solutions, suddenly the overhead becomes spread out over 3, 4, 5. How are you going to manage that? So the attention for cost distribution, very important. Then attention for legal ICT components. Lots of people forget it, but you're connecting devices, you're connecting people, you're tracking people, you're putting connected devices, maybe at customers or maybe at another company. How legal is all of that? Do we need to change some contracting? Is that built into our platform? And then you will definitely go towards a multi-platform vision with a limited amount of platforms. That means that you need to be ready to compromise, because not everything will be handled in a platform the way you want it or the way which would be ideal. But compromise is part of the game in IoT. Rapid prototyping. Make sure that the people that are developing it, if it's innovation or a business unit or somebody else, that they can work on rapid prototyping, which means that you can go very fast in the first leg of your IoT journey. You want to do that in a couple of days or a week. You don't want to spend too much time there. You want to have a quick go or fail element there. And that I often do by running some experiments, checking, and then rapid prototyping is very handy.
Isn't that usually the case when the company doesn't want to go into strategizing first? They just want a quick result and something to show up to the stakeholders to give them a further mandate to innovate, to go into the IoT.
Yeah, indeed. The thing is that you're looking at it from one solution, one solution at a time. You have to imagine that you might have 10 or 15 or 20 IoT solutions that are in the pipeline. suddenly it becomes very difficult to manage all of those if you don't have rapid prototyping and you have like development cycles for each one. You need to make heavy budgets for each of the solutions, and it goes on for years, and then you have a problem with resources. So you want to put your time, effort, and money there where you see that you're making progress, and for that you do need rapid prototyping. And it's part of your strategy. It's part of your build or buy solution, and which solutions do we buy, which solutions do we build. So that's company per company different. Right? Very quickly going through this one, it's a business unit, a CEO or innovation that says, hey, let's do something together. We need a platform for multi-solution. Then they look at one or two solutions. Usually, sometimes they need to open a job offering because they don't have the right competences. They work on the architecture, do some tests, and then they make a business plan. And if one business plan gets approved, then they go further and then they deploy, put the SLAs and everything in. This is mainly driven by IT. This is fine, but the red thing is very difficult because there you interact with people which are out of the realm of IT. You need to create innovation cycles. You need to test technologies which are unknown to IT. You need to look at new functionalities, limitations. You need to look at operational aspects that are totally different from the ones that IT has currently, because currently they do monitor data centers and switches and everything, so they need to secure all of these things. They're not so used in managing equipment they don't know, and IoT is largely unknown. It's a little microcomputer, but what are we allowed? Do we put it on the network? What do we do with access control and so on? Those things are still very unclear, and it's a sequential process for most companies. Which means that this takes a very long time. And if you then have two or three solutions you want to push through, again, you need to make some compromise. You need to have a structure in place, because otherwise this red section, it will stop everything. And we see that coming back in why and where do projects fail? I split it up in before deployment of the platform. So before you're doing it, you're trying to make some cost calculations and so on. And then you take one or two use cases and you estimate that they will bring like 50K a year and the second one 70K a year. And then you calculate what the platform costs. And then the platform costs 300K. It comes in front of the CEO, and they say, oh, "Okay, this is not worth it. We're not making any money on it. Why would we do it?" And it's a correct assessment, but it's because we don't look at the full opportunities, the full set of opportunities of IoT. We don't look what it can do for different business units. We don't see that, okay, we can measure the machine and do machine monitoring, but we also can use that same data for sustainability. So you have this multi ROI calculation, which is often not done because it's not complex. It's just, it involves a lot of stakeholders. And once you start working in bigger companies with stakeholders and people, then it just takes long, and people, they lose interest in IoT because it takes like 6 months, a year before they see results, and then they say, okay, well, let's focus on something else. Something else will come up. During the deployment of the platform, there's missing competences, and there's a lot of change management, because as IoT is often new, you will end up with a backlog of solutions, and then the backlog of solutions, they will change it and it will continue changing. We need multi-tenancy. We need to have this tool. This needs to be developed extra if we want to deploy it. We need a management tool. We need to update our devices. And because it's new and nobody has done like 10 or 15 sequentially of those, it often gets stopped there. And if you do it after deployment, and I already mentioned that on the previous slide, it's working with peoples and processes and change management, and then it's a question, which mandate do you have to direct all of these different teams and business units to work the way you want to work? Also, IoT is a crucial part of an IoT solution, because it's a support function. It's not, you need to build your select your IoT platform or your solutions. You need to select in function of your use cases. And if you put your platform first, you don't do that. You build your solutions on what you have. And that's not always ideal.
Just to sum it up, so you don't encourage direct business unit IT cooperation on a case-by-case basis because the IT unit is not going to be like the sole guardian of the policies and the security above of it all.
Well, the security... The security probably, yes, but it's not fully in their scope and it's definitely not completely in their comfort zone. I gave some lectures for students at university regarding IoT, and the only thing that made their eyes shine was when we talked about architecture of an IoT solution on AWS. And I'm like, yeah, but there's still people that need to manage this. You need to change your structure. There's nobody prepared in an organization to suddenly go and change batteries. That's a different responsibility, and you might need to reshape your team. You have a lot of discussions about IT-OT conversion, which means that responsibility shifts, tool shift, all of these elements, they become part of this complexity. And it's not the IoT, it's not the IT tools, it's not the cloud environment, it's not the on-premise environment that dictates that. It's a tool, you need it, but you need it to be in support of what you want to achieve as a strategy. So it's on the second plane. The same for innovation, it's on the second plane. Same for the business units, it's basically on the second plane. Let's see if I missed anything there. Long innovation cycles, that's definitely true. There are a lot of unexpected elements that come up and missing competences as well. IoT is new. Let's call a cat a cat. I wanted to use the cat here. It's new. There's not that much experience out there. And even somebody that worked on IoT or did a project on IoT, they probably did it with one or two technologies. And then you have some other technology that pops up and they don't have the experience, and then it starts again. Also, people that have then the IoTs, people, they get hired to do IoT things. But who really has this end-to-end view? I know maybe three or four people in Europe that have that know that the color of a device impacts your legal can impact your legal responsibilities. So all of these things, they are connected, and the choices that you make, they're very important for building solutions. I think it's up to Samak again to have a quick
jump into a quick survey. I'm gonna do that quickly. All right. Our guest, does IT have the mandate to change the commercial strategy in your company? Please vote now. That's a very interesting question, actually, because from our perspective, the technology usually drives business changes, but let's see how it looks like in your company. All right, let's give it a 5 more seconds, please.
Yeah, and I'll give the answer for the latecomers because the 5 seconds are up. It's sometimes. And that really reflects the need for a portfolio manager, because...
Let me share the votes. So you can see they're pretty much split equally. 50-50, so...
Yeah, I don't see the bottom of it, but it is sometimes, and that means that sometimes when the CEO says, yeah, we need to do it, then they get the mandate, but the mandate is then coming from the CEO, not from IT. So and because you have change management inside of your company per definition as part of your IoT roadmap, which means that somebody needs to dictate to other business units, hey, we're going to work like this now. And that's not often in the realm of IT, except when they get the mandate from the CEO. And this already reflects the vision that we need to go a bit higher to position the IoT responsible, or next to, or in parallel. going to the last element, it's if it starts at innovation. And I didn't want to make a roadmap because innovation, it depends so much. I've been with really excellent innovation teams. I work together with them, worked as part of them. And they all work differently, and some are focused on buy and try. Other ones are focused on develop, on R&D. Anyway, it doesn't really matter there. There's some request that comes in, can be from a business unit or can even be from the right. CEO. And then it's up to them to build and try the solution. The first challenge there is, I would say, they need to be involved in all IoT projects if they want to build some knowledge or they want to build some kind of portfolio management or some innovation management. And they are not. They are not involved in the purchase of a CNC machine. They're not involved in the purchase of a coffee machine. So they don't have that. And then also innovation roadmap, you cannot copy it one-on-one on an IoT roadmap. Because there's a lot of elements that you need to add to this one. You need to check the security of your device. You need to make sure that it can be deployed. You need to think about vandalism. You need to think about elements that usually are not part of an innovation roadmap. And then, again, there are no specific guidelines for IoT. What are they going to check about? If it works, yes, in laboratory it works. And then you have a sensor that goes into an aluminium factory and suddenly, hey, it doesn't work anymore. The signal bounces off the metal. Or you put a sensor inside of a container and you say, hey, this worked in the lab. Why doesn't it work anymore? It's the Faraday elements. Also, they really don't work on scalability. And same thing for IT. They're not used to changing the business model and the processes behind it. Innovation is not always scalable. And they do think in an agile way, which I love working together with them. But you need to have some structure in place as well. You need to have a checklist. If you want to evaluate 50 solutions, then it becomes very, 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 very hard to do them in parallel. So you need to have something robust in place, which we will look at in the last webinar, how you do it. There's also a different team. They're not used to do a legal check for everything. So there's a lot of elements that are missing there. Is innovation crucial in an IoT section? I would say yes. Is IT crucial? Yes. Is the business unit crucial? Yes, because you need a sponsor, you need some directives above it. What do we want to achieve long term? How do we think about batteries in devices? Do we want to only put without batteries because it's better for sustainability, for the environment? What do we want to do? What are our guidelines? And without those guidelines, you'll always come up with solutions, but afterwards you think, oh, we shouldn't have done that. So here, I love projects starting in innovation, but they need to have a separate mandate. They need to have a mandate that says, okay, everything which is connected at any point, we just want it to come in into our bucket. We'll look at it. If it's IoT, we'll think about it. Somebody needs to coordinate sustainability. I want to have energy monitoring. Industry 4.0, I want to do energy monitoring to build a preventive maintenance model. Yeah, well, you're doing two times the same thing. Let's combine those. So somebody needs to coordinate it. That's your portfolio manager, basically. So I give a spoiler for the next session. We have another quick survey.
Yeah, we're going to jump into that real quickly because we're at the very end of our meeting. But the question is, does your innovation team have the right skills to build new end-to-end solutions? Please don't hesitate to cast your votes now.
Yeah, we will close them. I already answered that one. We should have done it before.
You might have different experience than our guests as well.
Yeah, and I know some of the guests that are here that have a really great team, because I had some sessions with them and they have the right vision. I don't know if they implemented it because it was a few years ago.
Fair enough. I'll be closing down the poll just now. So thank you for your votes. And back to you, Chris.
All right. So just summarizing, and it's a visual. I love visuals too. So it sticks. So on one side, you have your often current strategy, the successful ones where you buy a solution and you, maybe you hook it up to an analytics tool if you want to have that data. On the other side, you have like the topics we discussed, the portfolio management, contextualization of your data. You have your IoT, your IT security policies. Next to that, the IoT security policies, you have support and maintenance, and you do a constant cost optimization. This is versus this solution. So that's what everybody's scared. Oh, it's a lot of blocks and we need to put some time, but it's your foundation. If you don't put your foundation, you get this, and this is the same amount of solutions. And then you want to add it to an SAP, you want to do operational optimization, and it becomes really, really hard to not only manage that, but just, can anybody say like, this doesn't scare me? This is what we're often going for today, because it goes quick, but quick is not nice and tidy. So as a key takeaway, there are dangers everywhere. And I would say definitely for the people that are working in IT, we know what is shadow IT, the time that everybody started installing Dropboxes until they thought, oh, these viruses go into the Dropbox, they go into the company, and then there's no virus scan done, and then it becomes a problem and everybody start doing whatever they wanted. We're going towards shadow IoT today. So we need to be very careful there. We need to look at how we can standardize the approach. And this is not only for the solution itself, this is for the maintenance. How can we standardize this? How can we have a solid legal approach on this one? How do we do cost distribution? How do we do profit management and so on? And that all starts with central decision making, cross BU, cross company, even towards the supplier and towards the end customer. So the full connected company, it needs to have a centralized vision. I'm looking at the time, so we have like 5 minutes left, which is on time. I know I go quickly and too much over it, too fast over certain things.
I'm gonna spoil a bit, because this is something that is actually one of our guests' questions. So how do you start on the IoT in general? How do you do it right?
Yeah, well, there is no rocket science. It's just a lot of steps that you need to take. Now, if you want to go very, very, you don't want to go too quick. You want to take some time, put the foundations right. And what I suggest is to do first a topology. Like, what happened today? We have already IoT. Let's put that on a map. It doesn't matter if it's a CO2 monitoring tool or if it's a fleet management tool. Let's already look at what we have from data. And then look also, how was this approved? Was innovation involved? Who was this? Was security involved? Is this process clear? Because once you have that, you can analyze it and see where are possible risks with one of those solutions. What went well? Because if it went well, then you want to use that process, modify it a bit so it fits perfectly. Also, what went wrong? What do we want to avoid? What do we need to fix? And what can we tolerate for now? We don't have to change everything, but we need to be aware of what is coming at us. So the first one, topology, it's a mapping. It's somebody that every business analyst can do. Just look at what has done, ask some questions, put it in a map, and already that, knowing what dangers there are already today in your company, it helps you sleep a bit better, because there's nothing worse than an unknown. Then the second one, the analysis, and then the last one, and this is for each company a bit different. You want to start building a living document with your vision and strategy on IoT. You set up some guidelines, you set up rules, and then different frameworks. and operational framework, innovation, ecosystems, IT, you want to make sure that you have a quality delivery of each new IoT solution that is conform, that is well documented, and this is based on basically a checklist. We're going to do it like this. Did we do it like this? Yes. Okay, then it's confirmed. Yeah. And at the end, having this, it will help you speed up any deployment. It's putting the foundations right. It's easier to put up a wall if you have the right foundations than if you don't have any foundations at all. And that's one. So that's it. Company strategy, avoid IoT. It needs a specific IoT approach because it impacts people and it is transformational. That's basically my closure. IoT is here to stay. So cope with it, but think about it. And we're here to help anyway. We're going to lose the fifth survey and then maybe jump to the questions and answers.
So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for sticking with us for the biggest part of our presentation. And now moving back into the Q&A, if you have any questions, don't hesitate to pose them now. Here's one for you. So what is the best first? We already touched on that, but if you can just circle back, what's the best first step when thinking about IoT for the production company?
Yeah. It's a bit what I said. It's having this as a situation. What do we already have today? And it's not only the topology, but also the process behind it.
How would you approach it as a consultant?
Well, the thing is that what I don't try to do is revolutionize processes. We want to see how the current processes can be slightly modified to fit IoT. Often you need some external expertise. If you don't have IoT expertise, then who's going to steer this thing? So often companies want to have some experience brought in to help them with this process. At the end, somebody needs to be responsible inside of the company, and that's not necessarily consultant, rarely is. So we do a lot of knowledge transfer, and then we're still consulted for specific cases afterwards.
And the second question that we have here is, what should the MVP for IoT solution be like? The strategy looks very complex. How can we test it in a smaller scale and then build up from there?
Well, the first thing you want to do is you want to make a long list of opportunities. You want to see where does IoT fit in our company. And this can be for CO2. This can be for checking that the windows are closed or stopping the air conditioning to turn down or making sure that the plants are watered automatically, making sure that we have an optimization of the meeting rooms. And this is then tertiary in the industry. You want to say, okay, we can monitor waste. We can do preventive maintenance on machines. We can monitor machines in the field. We can deploy machine XYZ as a service instead of trying to sell it because it gives more margins. So the first thing you want to do is make that list. What does IoT mean for us in the broad sense of the word? And then the second thing you do is you put them in different categories. You put them in a category industry. You put an index on there. And the index would then define which type of network, which type of security you need to put on there. And that might be different because the heavier you make, the more expensive it will cost. So you will have the multi-platform strategy where you have a certain number of solutions that are maybe on a cheaper platform, some others on another platform, maybe local with an edge instance, maybe have a BIM tool, building information management tool that you want to deploy. So
right. And quick question from me, Chris. What are the low-hanging fruits now for the industrial IoT use cases?
That really depends from company to company. There's a lot of interest in energy management these days with the high prices, the gas prices, and so on. If you have a gas oven and you can turn it off 30 minutes earlier because you change your processes or you make some things more efficient by having the data processed, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Same for building management. Do we still need five floors heated? It's the same thing. Do we gonna stimulate people to walk more at work, to take the stairs more, because they'll stay more healthy? There's so many solutions, and I really talk about, if you do a brainstorm with any company, if we don't have 50 solutions at the end of the day, then I don't know what you're doing as an organization. Then it's like a one-man organization. So we always have multiple solutions. The thing is that they're tackled individually and not within a strategy.
We have a question from Dennis. Don't you use iterations of implementation of different IoT solutions in real industry automation via IoT? Concepts and strategy are huge. Isn't it easier to divide the implementation into iterations and repeat all of those actions in circles?
Whew.
It's a question of how you implement Agile on a industrial scale.
Well, definitely you want to test some things. What I would do that, and I don't know if it's a question to your answer, but I would have a dev environment fully retrofit where you don't interact with the network and build your solution there. And then once it's fully worked, then you implement it in life. But iterations in a real industry automation, in a production environment, I would limit the iterations as much as possible because it always has impact on what you're doing. So,
thanks, strategy.
Yeah, well, the industry requires some additional attention because there are a lot of changes there. They're different worlds. You have OT world, which is the PLCs and the machines and how they talk. They have a special code, and then you have IT. On the other side, where they talk in different codes, they talk in applications, and they have a totally different mentality. OT will think for the next 10 years, IT will think, oh, in the next 2 years, we'll change the application and so on. So the difference in continuity and speed of innovation is already very different. Then there are some changes going on. If you have a multiple plant, then you might want to put maintenance and security more centrally to optimize and to make sure that you have more continuity. But that means that your tools need to change as well. The tools to connect to these PLCs need to change. And that's this transition, and the responsibilities, roles and responsibilities within your organization change. So that's five webinars by itself, this one.
All right. Thank you, Chris. We're not going to go into that any further today, but we encourage your direct contact. Thank you for sticking with us a little bit longer. And as said, we're going to be welcoming you into our further webinars when we dive deeper into the subject. Thank you for that. I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Thanks, Chris, for guiding us through the meanders of IoT.
You're welcome. Hope to see you next time.
Bye.